Thank you. Now we're going to hear some famous words from the Bible from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. And Nick's daughter Camilla is going to read this for us. Thank you, Camilla.
A reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. Hear the word of the Lord.
My help come? It comes from the Lord. To round out our hearing parts of God's word, the Bible, Karen's going to read us the words of the Lord Jesus that are usually called the Beatitudes. Thank you, Karen.
The second lesson from Matthew 5, 1 to 10. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Hear the word of the Lord. And if I may, I'd just like to say something personally to Simon. I'd just like to take this opportunity to say to you what a blessing you have been to your dad in his final years. We have watched you care for your dad so much. I pray you find peace, or Glenn and I pray you find peace and comfort knowing you honoured your dad, Simon, as the Bible instructs us to do. God bless you, Martin, Nicholas, and family. Thank you.
True words, true words. We're going to hear about John's life now. Firstly, Nick, and then Simon. Come on up.
I will tell some stories about Dad. He had a long life, so there are many stories to tell. I hope that at least some of them you have not heard before, and that they give you a better understanding of who Dad was. We are also keen to hear your stories, and we hope that as many of you as possible stay and join us in the church hall, where we can share many memories. Jenny, my wife, has organised some sandwiches, scones and other treats, all of which Dad was fond of. Dad was born in Neutral Bay in Sydney on the 28th of August 1927. He had two older sisters, Anne and Beth. Dad stayed close to his sisters during their long lives. Anne died 4 years ago, aged 96. Beth died 2 years ago, aged 96. Dad's father, James Hunter Stephenson, known as Jim or Jazz H, was a third generation Australian. His forebear, George, from Yorkshire, sailed out in 1841 with his wife and baby son. We still have the original ticket. Dad's father gained a Bachelor of Arts and a Bachelor of Laws from Sydney University and practised as a solicitor in the city. Jazz H was a keen amateur photographer, and most, if not all, the older photos that you will see later are his. Dad's mother, Helen Ann Poole, had a forebear that sailed out in 1826. Helen was a practical woman who, before marrying, used to housekeep and cook for one of her brothers who was a farmer, including in Yenda, New South Wales, near where I live now. She also liked the beach and entertaining. She and Jim first met on the Corso at Manly. The family moved around a lot during the Depression, mainly in Killara, but then returned to Neutral Bay. That is one of the reasons Dad became a keen sailor. His medical yearbook entry jokingly mentions that he was often seen upside down in the harbour. Dad went to the shore school, so the family were doing all right. During this time, which was during the Second World War, while his sisters stayed with their mother in Sydney on the school holidays, Dad was sent upcountry to his mother's siblings' properties in the New England area. These uncles and aunts had boys, which is why Dad was sent there for the holidays. He travelled there and back by train. He said that the trains were always packed, including a lot of war widows. He used to give up his seat for these widows, and he was very grateful for his cadet greatcoat as he lay on the floor of the carriage trying to stay warm to sleep. And if you've ever been on those New England trains in winter at night, you will know how cold they get. They get very cold. Dad said that at the time, that time he spent up in the country on those holidays is the reason he wanted to bring up his family in the country. Dad's two older sisters, Anne and Beth, married the two Cowper brothers, Bill and Tony, and they stayed in Sydney, so we became the country cousins. Incredibly, all four of them, the two Stephenson women and the two Cowper men, all lived into their late 90s. Dad studied his medical degrees at Sydney University, where, amongst other things, he was a keen hockey player. He graduated in 1951. He was then a junior house officer, as they were called, at the old Prince Henry Hospital in Little Bay. The junior doctors in those days were virtual prisoners, although not quite like the real prisoners in the nearby Long Bay Jail. Dad said he needed permission to leave the hospital grounds, and the gate staff had authority to block exit, and they also recorded all comings and goings. Dad then worked for a time at the old Royal Alexandra Hospital for Children in Camperdown when he knew of Mum. Apparently, Mum was talked about because she drove a ute, not a sedan car. Dad was then invited to enlist in the Royal Australian Navy. A family friend, high up in the services, realised that the RAN did not have an Australian-born medical officer in its ranks. Can you believe it? They were all British or Irish. So Dad got offered to be the medical officer on the ship that sailed around the world for the coronation of Her Majesty the Queen Elizabeth II in 1953. He used to say that he sailed around the world on the grey funnel line. He also said there was always a big party in every port, including Rio de Janeiro. That would have been one. Dad was then required to serve on the HMAS Sydney, the aircraft carrier helping support the Allies in the Korean War. To reach the carrier, he was flown from Australia to Hong Kong via Darwin, Singapore, and goodness knows where else. When he got to Honkers, before he boarded a destroyer to take him up to the war, he had to spend a night at the Peninsula Hotel. He distinctly remembered being booked into a small, far-off room, the key to which was covered in dust, so much so that the hotel receptionist blew the dust off the key before handing it to Dad. The war probably ended as he got to the aircraft carrier. Nonetheless, he did service on her. Unfortunately, the sick bay was directly beneath the flight deck, and he says his ears rang constantly from the extreme noise of the steam-driven catapult. Returning to Australia by ship, he developed many memories, including of Japan, that was still recovering from the war. All the women still wore kimonos. It was a different era. During his service, he formed a lifelong friendship with Tom Fisher, a ship's engineer. Tom rose to the rank of Commodore and later became the commanding officer of the Garden Island Naval Base in Sydney. After finishing his period of service, Dad then went to London for more medical training and experience, including getting the Diploma of Child Health. During this time, he went to see some friends off on a train at Victoria Station. And coming back through the turnstiles, he ran into Mum when they recognised each other. Soon after, there must have been some mutual friends who wanted to go to the continent for a long camping holiday. So four of them, two young men and two young ladies, went camping together on the continent. Mum had the car for the four of them, but there was no room on the ferry, to Calais. So she drove off, found some nearby airport, flew over with the car, getting to the ferry terminal at Calais before the others arrived. She was resourceful. It was an old-fashioned camping trip, the two young men sharing a tent, if the weather required it, and the two young ladies in their own tent. Dad said it was an incredible trip. In the days before mass tourism, sleeping on the beaches of the Côte d'Azur, and plenty of free parking outside the Colosseum in Rome. Dad fell in love with Mum and proposed to her on the route to Avignon. Mum said she would think about it. Well, why not? And finally accepted the proposal in Paris. I guess if you're going to accept a proposal for marriage, it may as well be Paris. For the boat trip home, they did the right thing and took separate boats, as you would. Dad worked as a medical officer on a cargo ship, and while in the Indian Ocean, the boat's captain got a severe tonsillitis infection, developing an abscess in the back of his throat. Dad, like all medical students, had been taught about such abscesses, called a quinsy, but had never had to lance and drain one before. Nonetheless, he did, and the captain recovered promptly. It was just another one of Dad's many stories. Dad and Mum were married at the family church in Kalara, February 58, and then had to be driven to the Royal Sydney Golf Club in Rose Bay for the reception. Mum's grandfather, Aubrey A. King, put on a glittering show for his only granddaughter. Of course, they had to drive over the Sydney Harbour Bridge to get to the reception. Mum used to say that it was so heavily pouring with rain that they could barely see where they were going. Dad's strongest association with the Harbour Bridge was through his godfather, Frank de Groot. Frank was the man that cut the ribbon on the opening day before Premier Jack Lang could. Dad's father bailed Frank out of the lockup and then subsequently convinced a magistrate that Frank was merely clearing an obstruction on a public road. Jack Lang was not amused, and Lang and his family kept the jewel-encrusted scissors made for the occasion, which is what every good socialist would do. Frank's sword was kept in the family until it was bought by the bridge climb entrepreneur. Dad was given another sword by his godfather, Frank, Lieutenant Stirling's naval cutlass. This was presumably the James Stirling who rose to the rank of admiral and started the Swan River colony in Western Australia. It's still in the house. Anyway, Dad and Mum chose to settle in Bathurst, and in fairly quick succession had Martin, then me. Simon was a few years later. Mum used to say that she and Dad lost the recipe for a while. Those are her words. Dad was very busy working as a country GP, including delivering babies, providing anaesthetic services, and being the paediatric specialist in the town for many years. Mum would have been busy with two boys. The group practice that Dad joined in Bathurst was the reason they ended up in Bathurst, not in Maitland, say, where Mum came from, or New England, where Dad had extended family. The two senior doctors who joined there were specialists, one a surgeon, Brooke Moore, the other a physician, Ralph Cameron. Although all worked as generalists, including all of them delivering babies. You know, how times have changed in the medical profession. Dad delivered me himself because Ralph Cameron, who was looking after Mum during a pregnancy, happened to be in Sydney when she went into labour. On Christmas Day, we would all attend All Saints Cathedral in Bathurst, which was always packed. And in the early days, then go with a large crowd to Brooke and Freda Moore's home for drinks before Christmas lunch. The group practice crew would always stay together for lunch. After the main course, Dad and Brooke would disappear for a while the others cleaned up. Dad said that every Christmas Day, Brooke would somehow find an acute appendicitis. Dad would gas the patient while Brooke cut out the inflamed appendix. Martin, Simon and I grew. Then Mum and Dad decided they wanted to leave Bathurst, ostensibly because they didn't like the winter cold. I was put into boarding school for 3 months while they travelled up the Queensland coast with Simon and Martin for part of the way. When they got to Palm Cove, they fell in love with far north Queensland. Well, it was the dry season. 16 months later, they packed up and moved after I finished high school. So in 1979, they moved to Cairns and they've been in Whitfield and Edgehill ever since. Dad started again in a new group practice, which included John Knott's father. Dad established himself as an excellent and popular doctor. Both bishops, Anglican and Catholic, were his patients. He helped start the after-hours clinic at Calvary Hospital, which unfortunately was undermined by an evangelical Catholic who complained to the Vatican, and the bishop told him to close it. Sorry, he was told by the bishop to close it. He was active in the local AMA branch, helped Calvary with its first accreditation, was on the board of a homeless child charity, and was very active in this church. And I forgot to mention that while in Bathurst, Dad was an enthusiastic teacher of nurses and St John's ambulance staff. Many of you here know about the rest of his life in Cairns, as does Simon. So I'll not bore you with more of the more recent stories other than to say that Dad was an incredibly devoted husband to Mum during her long dementia illness. Dad also unconditionally loved his three sons. He also dearly loved my wife, Jenny, and my daughter, Camilla, his only grandchild. Even in later years, Dad regularly travelled down south to visit my family and his sister's families. Jenny, Camilla, and I loved hosting him on our farm, where he also enjoyed the company of our dogs and the garden in all its seasons. Dad was a humble man and a quiet achiever. Thankfully, he kept his calm demeanour throughout his dementia. He will be very sorely missed. Thank you.
One of the best pieces of advice that Cameron and several others of you have given me is not to apologize if I cry, and I won't. It's lovely to see you all here today. It's a testament to my father's longevity that there are actually not more of you here today. 96 years, 7 months, and 7 days. Had he died 10 years ago, there would be more people here from both halves of his life. From the first half of his life in New South Wales, there would be Cowpers, the family into which both his sisters married, and representatives from the other great families of our childhood, such as Darziel and Gebhardt and Lowenthal. From his time here in Cairns, there would also be many more people. Had my father died 20 years ago, St. Monica's Cathedral would not have been large enough to contain us all. I know this because one of the joys of the last week has been discovering inscriptions in books and cards and letters from patients of old that my father had kept. As William Blake wrote, joy and woe are woven fine, a clothing for the soul divine. Under every grief and pine runs a joy with silken twine. For every one letter or card my father has kept over the years, I'm sure there are 10 or 20 or 50 others that hadn't made it. On the back of the order of the service today, you'll see a picture of our family at Christmas time. At the Christmases of my youth, there was always a cornucopia of gifts from Dad's patients. Shortbread and nuts, glacé fruit and chocolate, fruitcake and whiskey. Always the whiskey from the Catholic priests. Dad and I shared many interests over the decades. One of them is music, classical music, and the glories of Anglican church music. We had attended Evensong at Westminster Abbey once, such a delight for us both. When we bought Dad a record player a couple of years ago, one of the first records he wanted to play was a recording of the choir at All Saints Cathedral in Bathurst, a choir in which Martin was a member. Memorably, in that recording, there's a part where Martin's voice emerges from the rest. Mum particularly loved that part as well. So now the inspiration for the music for today's service is clear. Maybe the music is too big for the space of this church. If you feel this way, then let it serve as a metaphor for how the expansiveness and kindness let it serve as a metaphor for how the expansiveness and kindness of my father overwhelmed us all in the best possible ways. My father and I also both loved books and words. At an extended family Christmas in about 1991, I asked for and received from him the 2-volume shorter Oxford English Dictionary. There were those present who were new to the Stephenson clan, such as Jenny and Martin's Irene. Those that were new were a little bemused and mystified by this presence of a dictionary. They found it hard to believe I spent half the day with my nose between the pages. But Dad shared in the pleasure of my discovering of new words, exotic meanings, and curious etymologies. The little corridor outside my father's bedroom door is narrowed by bookcases stuffed with books, many of which in turn were the property of his father and grandfather. Down at least 4 generations of Stephensons, we write our name and the year in the front cover. I still remember the thrill when as a boy I discovered for the first time a book that belonged to my great-grandfather, who was also called John Stephenson. My father spoke fondly over the decades of how this other John Stephenson, father of his father, would take him sailing in Sydney Harbour. Perhaps this was the origin of his love of sailing and all things nautical. Perhaps this in turn inspired him to join the Navy. You can see a photo of him as a young lieutenant in the order of service. If I had to guess, this was taken in the wardroom of the HMAS Sydney. As my brother mentioned, my father sailed to England as a member of an official military delegation attending the coronation of Queen Elizabeth II. That trip was a highlight of his life, and he spoke often of its details. The funeral of our late Queen was of great interest to him, although he had difficulty now and again wrapping his head around the fact that this sovereign was dead. I get it, Dad. I get it. Speaking of that 1953 journey, one of the details that only appeared in the last year was a stopover in Japan. Our GP, the Esmal Mike Smith, heard the beginnings of this story as well when he came to visit Dad in the hospital one day. Dad told us how, during a call at a Japanese port, he was approached by several fine young ladies. Looking at that picture of him, it's not hard to see why. "Do go on," I encouraged him. But there was no going on, and there was no carrying on. This is also a thread of my father's character. I have several lines of evidence that he was completely and joyfully faithful to my dear mother, even after her death. If you know only a fraction of the story of how he cared for her in her last years, this is no surprise. The number of times I called my father John to his face, I can count on one hand with fingers to spare. It was in hospital 14 months ago when I was desperately trying to get his attention as he lapsed into a delirium of pain and confusion. Another name I certainly never called my father to his face was Johnny. Johnny, however, was the name his two older sisters used with him. You can see a photo of the three of them just inside the cover of the Order of Service as well. In that photo, Dad is 6 years old. Perhaps it was in part to distinguish this John Stephenson from the grandfather John that the name Johnny was born. Perhaps it was because his older sisters doted on the younger brother, a strong love that lasted their whole lives. It's not a stretch to imagine my grandmother, Helen Stephenson, dandling her lovely son on her knee and calling him Johnny. Until quite recently, he would stop at that photo, which was in a prominent place in our living room, and another one next to it of him and his two sisters from about 15 years ago. And he would say how he loved his sisters. There was also a photo of you, Camilla, on the coffee table, at which he would often look and say, she's my favorite. By the way, if anyone has video of my father, I would dearly love to see it. Please let me know. One of the short piles of books in his bedroom has atop the hymnal produced by the BBC program Songs of Praise. The date he records inside the cover is 1998. He loved watching and listening to that program, and he would often do so after regular service here at the Good Shepherd. Another book in that particular pile is a New Testament that my father annotates as a gift from the Bishop of Goulburn the last time he came to dinner in Bathurst, 1962. I only discovered that inscription this week as well. Why the Bishop of Goulburn dined at my then young parents' table not just once, but apparently many times, is now a divine mystery. The fact that my mother was able to entertain such a guest with toddlers Martin and Nicholas to manage as well is a great credit to her. My father was curious about many things. Last Tuesday, the plumber came to repair the hot water tap in the kitchen, one of the minor annoyances of Dad's last weeks. He had been Dad's plumber for 14 years and was devastated to learn of my father's death. The repair took 5 minutes, but then the plumber sat and talked to me for over an hour. And come to think of it, he charged me for all that time. That's all right. Plumber therapy probably dates from the Romans. So as I say, my father was curious about many things. The plumber told me that one of the early times he visited Dad, my father was elbow deep in papers on neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity? I asked the plumber. Are you sure? Yes. Dad was trying to figure out how to help my mother, who at that time was being ravaged by Alzheimer's disease. It was roughly the same time that I'd been speaking to Dad about biology. I bought him the standard textbook on molecular biology of the cell. He ate it up, reading cover to cover. I now, and only now, in the light of the conversation with the plumber, know why he accomplished that feat, a feat I cannot claim, and a modern biology undergraduate would boast of. My father was unable to cure my mother. I, and indeed Dad's entire medical team were likewise powerless in the face of this terrible, terrible Alzheimer's disease. My father hated losing words. He hated losing names and forgetting histories of people. He hated not being able to talk to people on the telephone anymore, or how to make tea or coffee, or how to use the bathroom, or how to put on his shorts or button up his shirt, or not being able to understand what was being said. Not because his hearing aids were not doing, his new hearing aids were not doing sterling service, they were, but because his brain struggled to process the input. A number of you encouraged him to return to church after COVID. He confabulated a story of how he didn't want to sit next to someone in church and have them be alarmed at his snuffling or blowing his nose. The real reason was he was embarrassed. He could no longer talk to people as usual. Only later, when he was past caring, was I able to bring him again, the last time being about a year ago, when I had just brought him home from the hospital. He loved this church. He served on the parish council from 1996 to 2001. And was warden from 1998 to 2001. It was my father who called Trevor Saggers to offer him the job here. Caring for my father has taught me how we need to be brave, as he was in abundance. We need to look at death, we need to look at aging, and in particular, not shy away from the people we know and love who are aging and suffering the diseases of aging. It can be scary. It is often not pretty, but we have to face it. Two people who never looked away from my father are here today, and your help is pivotal. I'm speaking of Karen and Glenn Beatty. Your frequent visits when Dad was in the hospital for those 6 weeks early last year were essential. Your support to me was and has been likewise essential. Thank you. Penny Bates and John Knott were also reliable visitors to Dad while he was in hospital. Having the great John Knott visit was especially welcome, as it galvanized all the medical staff in the hospital who saw it, and as a consequence, they paid closer attention to my father. What is the meaning of my father's life? In asking that question, I'm reminded of a story told of the great 20th century pianist Arthur Rubinstein. After a recital, he was talking to an audience member who asked, "Mr. Rubinstein, I enjoyed your performance of the Chopin, but what does this piece mean?" Rubinstein was mute, held up a finger, returned to the piano, and played the piece again. Then Rubinstein replied, saying, "That's what it means." To give my father's life its full weight and scope, we'd have to rewind the videotape 96 years plus. How I would delight if those 847,000 hours existed. Sign me up for the box set. There's so much I would love to watch. No funeral, no eulogy, no statues or paintings, no plays or operas, no novels or films could do justice to my father's life. My Jewish friends, when hearing I am bereaved, use an excellent saying. May his memory be a blessing. May his memory be a blessing. At one level, this saying means, may it be a blessing to you when you remember your father, a consolation. But the other, deeper meaning of that saying is this. May the good your father did be something you emulate. In that way, his memory is not just a consolation, but the goodness he demonstrated. But the goodness he demonstrated expands by being kept alive in your actions. So my prayer for all of you, and my commission for all of you, is may my father's memory be a blessing. Two final words. The first is to quote from the closing paragraph of George Eliot's Middlemarch. His full nature spent itself in channels which had no great name on the earth. But the effect of his being on those around him was incalculably diffuse. For the growing good of the world is partly dependent on unhistoric acts, and that things are not so ill with you and me as they might have been is half owing to the number who lived faithfully a hidden life and rest in unvisited tombs. The second and final word to say is this: when my father arrives at heaven, the trumpets will sound for him.
Thank you.
Well, as we've heard, John grew up in Sydney in the 1930s. At that time, a man called Arthur Stace walked the footpaths of Sydney with a piece of chalk. And on footpaths and doorsteps, he wrote one word, eternity. Many people saw Arthur Stace's one-word message. I wonder if John did. Eternity struck a chord with many people, because everyone is amazed at times with the beauty, the complexity, the awesomeness, and the wonder of our worlds. Whether it be the vastness of space, galaxy upon galaxy, or the beauty and intricacy here of far north Queensland, or the amazing detail of the human body, which fascinated John. And the book of Ecclesiastes tells us that God has set eternity in our hearts, that is, that we're aware that there is more than just the here and now. That when we consider things like the beauty, the complexity, the awesomeness of creation, it's right and natural that we want to know more, like, what's behind all these things? How did they come about? And what's the point of everything? Well, Ecclesiastes helps us to answer our questions, because there is a time for everything, a season for every activity, because God has made it that way. We live in an ordered creation because there is a God of order who is the creator. And so there is a time to plant and a time to uproot, time to tear down and a time to build, time to keep and a time to give away, etc. Time for marriage. With John and Alex, there were many years of love, leading many years of John faithfully loving an unwell Alex, as we've heard. What a faithful husband. But now even John's long earthly life has come to an end, and now is the time to grieve. There is a time to die. God numbers our days. Now John's long time on this earth has ended too. And it's time to grieve for a father, a grandfather, a husband, a great friend, a church member who has gone. But we don't have to always grieve for the deceased themselves. For there can be eternal bliss with God, God's forever, where there is no getting old. There's no sickness, there's no death, but only and always good things, including the best thing, God Himself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And one day there will be a wonderful reunion for all of God's people, the day when today's tears won't even be a memory. That's the day that can await all of us, because that's what the truth-telling God tells each of us. Like that most famous verse, John 3:16, "For God so loved the world, He gave us His Son, that whoever believes will not perish but have eternal life." Whoever, me, you, our family, everyone who believes that Jesus is God in the flesh, that the Father sent Jesus because things are not right in our world. Today proves that. But death is an alien intruder into this world. This is not the way God made things. But He sent His Son to restore what we can't fix, to bring us back to Him. Because we had wandered far away. We were lost. Lost in running our lives our ways and ignoring God. Refusing to have the good creator and ruler of this world ruling over us. That's what the Bible calls sin, though we're all sinners. But God is full of compassion for lost strays. So He sent Jesus to die for billions of people, people like us, so that you and me can face up to God, admit that we've refused to live His way, and humbly ask for forgiveness, express our desire to follow Him as His child and disciple. And then for us to be astounded that Jesus died on the cross to pay for our sins, and be amazed that God can and does forgive undeserving people like me, like us, and wait for Jesus to return or for our death, whichever comes sooner, so that we will go home. Home to our God and home to the family, all the people of Christ who've ever lived, like John Hunter Stephenson. There is a time to be born and a time to die. For John, the time for both has come. For each of us, of course, one time has come and the other will come. So are you ready? Are you ready to spend eternity with God? Because then even if we're gone, we'll not be lost. We will be very much found. because God gives real and certain hope to all the people who worship Christ. If you are a Christian, know and feel this wonderful hope today. If you're not yet a believer, accept God's wonderful offer. Because God has set eternity in our hearts, and God offers eternity in paradise, worshipping his Son Jesus, so that death is not the victor, but we can be through Christ. And so today, amidst grief, there can be great hope, which can be a very great comfort. Thank you. In a moment, we are going to stand and sing, "I Vow to Thee, My Country." Please stand.
I ask you to, at the end of each prayer, to join with me in saying Amen, and I'd ask you to bow your heads for these prayers. Firstly, to give thanks for the life of John Stephenson. Father God, we thank you for the 96 and a half years of earthly life that you gave to John. We thank you for him, for our good memories of him, for the love and care he showed to his family and to many others. We thank and praise you that you, through your Son Jesus, provide for us, even if we forget to acknowledge it. And we thank you that your Son Jesus can now be our good shepherd and be with us through thick and thin, just as he was with John. We thank you that for John, the tribulations of this life and world are finally now over. Amen. Amen. I pray now for his family and friends. Father God, you comfort those who look to you for help. May all of us here today look to you for comfort and help. Strengthen with your love all who are grieving today, especially Martin, Nicholas, and Simon, and for the whole extended family. In this time of loss and sadness, reassure us of your presence and calm our hearts. Help us all to understand that Jesus came to conquer death and offer eternal life to all who will believe in him as Lord and therefore their shepherd. Amen. I say the prayers now for the days ahead. And finally, Father God, you live forever and do not change. Make us aware of the shortness and uncertainty of our own lives, and therefore our great need for Jesus Christ. By the power of your Holy Spirit, guide us through this present world in faith and in obedience to you, and in love to one another. Then, when we have served you in our day and generation, graciously receive us into your presence and the new heaven and earth to come. We pray this and all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And I ask you now to join with me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Amen.
Thank you, John. When the shadows of life lengthen, God is the one that you most want to have with you. So in a moment, we're going to stand and sing, Abide With Me. And then at the end, please remain standing. So please stand and let's sing.
Can be through clouds.
following those words, "Now we commit John's body into God's care." But of course, you do not say a farewell to your precious memories of him. Cherish them, for they will comfort you. And remember the words of the Lord Jesus, which can be a lived reality for you too. For he knew that he would be raised back to life, that he would return to heaven, and that he would get things ready for his people. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. I am the way and the truth and the life. And so I urge you, trust in Jesus, the death smasher, and you will have a place with him in eternal glory, in a paradise of eternal love." Friends, please bow your head as I pray a prayer of commitment. Almighty God, the Heavenly Father of all your people, you have given a sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life for every single one of your followers. In your keeping are all who have departed in Christ. We here commit the body of our dear brother John Stephenson to be cremated, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who died and was buried and rose again for us, and who shall change your people's mortal body, that it may be like his glorious body. Thanks be to God, who gives us victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Shortly we will exit, where you will be welcome to place our rose petals on the casket. Then there will be refreshments in the church hall just behind me, to which everyone is invited and most welcome. But let me now close with a blessing from the Bible, from the Apostle Paul's second letter to the Thessalonians. May these words be true for you in these days and weeks ahead. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Thank you, everyone.